So I will walk through the analysis we have done with a group of other scientists, that is the creation of a deep learning algorithm to look for core collapse supernova signals. So this is the outline of my talk. I will briefly introduce the neutrino-driven core collapse supernova. And then I will talk about some challenges in particular in the data. And then I will walk you through the approach that we decide to take to proceed in the analysis and also what we can improve in the next steps. So as you know, on a daily basis, astronomers discovered core collapse supernova in the universe, almost one per day. And the rate that we have for our galaxy, the Milky Way, is one core collapse supernova every 30 to 50 years. If you look at the plot at the beginning of this slide, in the upper part of this slide, you have the luminosity versus distance. And there are two different main broad categories of supernova, the type 1 and type 2. So type 1 is caused by runaway thermonuclear burning of white dwarf fuel to nickel. They are really bright, and for this reason, they are used as standard candles. They don't leave any remnant behind, and the amount of energy is released is order of roughly 10 to 51 erg. In the type 2 case, that is the one we are interested in, so the core collapse supernova, that's a result of the collapse of an iron core in an evolved massive star, where the mass is bigger than 8 solar masses usually. So the remnant is a neutron star or a black hole, and the energy released in the gravitational collapse is few times 10 to 53 ergs, most of which, about 99%, is radiated into neutrinos. We have seen once MeV neutrinos coming from the core collapse of the supernova 1987A on February 23rd, 1987. And this event was seen also in visible light. So the plots that you see on the right side of this slide are energy versus time for each of the detector that could reveal the neutrinos, Kamiokande, IMB, and Baksan. The total number of neutrinos that were detected were 24, and this event happened in the Large Magellanum Cloud, that is at a distance of 52 kiloparsec from Earth. Of course, it's really important to try to detect different probes for the same source. And in this case, what we wanted to detect is the signal of the neutrino, an MeV neutrino, and the gravitational waves. They are both produced, as we will see in a second, in the innermost region of the collapse of star, and so they can give us information about the dynamic of the source and on the nuclear equation of state and on the rotational state of the star. So massive stars spend the majority of their lives burning hydrogen, and so the product helium will settle in the center and will burn when temperature will be high enough. So if you take, for example, a massive star of 25 solar masses in the main sequence, this star will spend about 7 million years burning hydrogen. And so the process goes on, so the burning process goes on through carbon, oxygen, up to iron. And iron is one of the most tightly bonded nuclei. And this iron core builds up in the center of the star and is supported by electron degeneracy pressure. When the radiation pressure doesn't balance anymore gravity, the collapse starts. And so just before the collapse, so what you have is this distinct onion shell structure in which you can see progressively heavier elements that contain the ashes of the sequence of the nuclear burning stages. So what happened in the case of the neutrino-driven explosion? So we said that when the radiation pressure doesn't balance anymore gravity, the collapse starts. And the implosion of the star stops when the nuclear density is reached at the center with the formation of the protoneutron star. And the inner core at that point bounces back and creates pressure waves that will expand outwards, both in radius and mass. So the density behind the shock has decreased to a value where the electron neutrinos start to escape freely. And shortly after the core bounce, the neutrino emission carries away energy from the post-shock layers, and the condition of temperature and density drop at a point in which the plasma becomes more radiation dominated. So at this point, the supernova explosion happens only if the heating bind the neutrinos is strong enough. And so the shock can be pushed outwards to produce the supernova explosion and the nucleosynthesis of the elemental products that will be spread in the galaxy. So this is briefly what is the theory behind the neutrino-driven core collapse supernova. What I'm going to talk about now are three challenges, in my opinion, important. One is due to the rate of the observable core collapse supernova event, and the other two are related to the data, so the duty cycles of the detectors and the noise background that we find in the real data. So regarding the rates, as we said, the neutrino-driven explosion is likely the outcome of non-rotating progenitors or slowly rotating progenitors. And that can be the signal, the gravitational wave signal can be seen in advanced ground-based detector at a distance of about 5 kiloparsec. But this galactic event has a rate of 2-3%. If we instead consider the 1% of the cases in which we have the progenitor that is rapidly rotating, and so we are in the magnetorotational rotationally driven core collapse supernova case, we can enlarge the event horizon of this event to 50 kiloparsec. So despite the low rates, the signal from the core collapse are of huge scientific interest because they can give us information of the internal part, the internal engine of the collapse, and give us information about the whole dynamics that produce the collapse itself. The second thing that I want to mention is the duty cycle that is not 100%. That's due to the fact that interferometers are not always taking scientific data due to noise or due to commissioning time. that is needed to improve the sensitivity and the stability of the detector. But we don't risk to completely miss the signal, because having a large network of detectors helps us to have always one of the one or two detectors that are data taking. Regarding the noise is not only non-stationary, it's also Gaussian. And so the noise that is due to instrumental and environmental artifacts in the data can or might mimic the astrophysical signal that you're looking in the data. So to try to avoid this type of interference, you required multiple observation from all the detector in data taking. We consider data quality monitoring and recording of the environmental videos. So we have in place strategies for the glitch detection, both using machine learning and bias and interference. And in addition, we can also use external trigger electromagnetic or neutrino observations to reduce the time period to search on. So what was our approach? Considering the fact that the neutrino-driven mechanism as its key point in the neutrino flux that powers the supernova outburst, and in addition, we expect the gravitational wave to be generated in the inner core of the source. These two probes can give us the hint about the inner mechanism internal at the source. The issue is that gravitational waves are supposed to be extremely faint and other than rare in the in a ground-based detector like the interferometer. In fact, we could expect amplitudes of the metric tensor perturbation that range between 10 to 21 to minus 21 to 10 to minus 23. And so the issue is that we need to find a signal as usual buried in noise. And so our approach was to go for a machine learning algorithm to look for this type of signal in the gravitational wave data, considering the neutrino as the external trigger. So the starting point of our work was this paper, Crode et al. Crode is part of a worldwide search regarding the evolution of the progenitors into core collapse supernovas. And so in this case, the group was evolving a massive star of 15 solar masses, and they use 3D simulation, all the hydrodynamic equations, the neutrino transport, and the difference in the different case they use was the nuclear equation of state. So they used a soft equation of state and a stiff equation of state. So on the left, you have a frequency, a time frequency plot in which the soft equation of state is used with the same progenitor, so the 15 solar mass progenitor star. Pardon me. And on the right, you have the same type of plot, so again, a time frequency plot, but with the stiffer equation of state. So as you can see in the gravitational wave data, what is the common feature between the two plots is this raising arc that is describing the excitation of the G-modes, and so the evolution of the protoneutron star at the center of the core collapse. Instead, what is different is this signature that is called sending accretion shock instability, or for short, SASI, that is related to the motion of the convective layer outside the protoneutron star. In fact, as you can see from the simulation they made, so everything, so in the upper part of the slide, you see again the two plots we just look at. On the lower part is that you have on the left the simulation in the case of the soft accretional state, and on the right the simulation with the same progenitor mass but with the stiffer accretional state. And so you see around 150 milliseconds, you will see a sloshy motion of the convective layer around the protoneutron star. And this is the motion, the evolution of this motion that creates this characteristic feature in the time frequency plot. And for the rest, it's almost the same. So there is only the excitation of the G modes. So what we have are two different scenarios. We are interested in the neutrino-driven core collapse supernova, so the non-rotating scenario or the slowly rotating one, in which the feature in the time frequency plot are distinct. And so you have a prompt convection, you have this raising arch that is the excitation of the G modes that describes the evolution of the protoneutron star. And then you have here the SASI signature. Instead, in the rapidly rotating scenario, what may happen is that the two signatures, one of coming from the G modes and one from the SASI, could merge together, and so it's even more difficult to detect them into the data. So since we cannot afford to have 3D full simulation of the core collapse supernova, what we use was something else, so phenomenological waveforms. So the aim of this waveform is to mimic the excitation of the G modes, so the raising arch that you have seen in the time frequency plot. And so the idea is that at each time in the Voss bunch evolution, the protoneutron star is in quadrihedrostatic equilibrium, and any perturbation will excite the diagonal modes of the system, and in particular the G modes. And these modes are continuously excited by any presence of non-linearities and instability. Therefore, the gravitational wave emission can be modeled as a damped harmonic with a random forcing in which the frequency varies with time. So what you see here is the in the table, you have the parameter space that we use to create the phenomenological waveforms. On the left upper plot, you have the strain versus time. And on the lower plot, you have frequency versus time, in which you clearly see this the signature of the evolution of the protoneutron star through the excitation of the G modes. This type of waveforms is more flexible than the previous one that we use in the previous work. And in addition, we added the distance as parameter. So the strategy that we follow is that we consider to have the neutrino information coming from, for example, this new collaboration and this new network. And so when we know where to look in the data, we train the machine learning pipeline to recognize the feature of the evolution of the G modes. the for the learning phase, the convolutional neural network is feed through time frequency plots that are created to the well-known coherent wave burst pipeline. And then for the classification, instead, we use a numerical simulation coming from the literatures. So since we use real detector data, we started with the triple coincidence scientific data during the second scientific run of the advanced detector. So the network is composed of the two LIGO detectors, M4D-Livingstone and the Virgo detector. CAGRA joined the data taking in the last observing run. So in this analysis, it's not present as a detector in the network. So I was saying that we use, pardon me, we use coherent wave burst, that is a well-known algorithm developed in the LIGO-Virgo collaboration to create the scalograms, so the time frequency plot, that we feed the machine learning algorithm to learn the training class. And so the pipeline decomposed the data stream at different time frequency resolution levels. And then the chosen level is considered as the input for the neural network. These are a couple of examples of the injections that we feed the pipeline with. So we decided to go for a machine learning algorithm because we wanted a hierarchical structure that was able to describe and combine different features in the time frequency plot. And the weights of the network that are iteratively updated using the Gauss function that in our case is a binary cross entropy is related to the classification error. And so, well, in particular, we use the convolutional neural network that is biologically inspired trainable architecture. And in what we wanted to mimic is the relation between the eye and the brain. In fact, the eye is the optical system that creates the upside down image on the retina that receives and converts the light into neural signals and send them to the visual recognition part of the brain that elaborates the data and builds the final image. And that's exactly what we aim to do, starting from pixel, looking at edges, combining the edges, and then complete the final object. So that in our case is the signal that we want to look for. So the training stage, that is the process of learning for the algorithm, is the one in which the algorithm needs to achieve the minimization of the loss function. Instead, the test stage is the one in which the output will represent the probability data belonging to each of the training class that the algorithm has seen during the learning phase. So in just to recap, we generate a set of data that are consistent with our problem and decide how to map the properties of the system. The data are split into various sets, training set, validation set, and test set. And then the model is trained by optimizing its performance, measuring the cost function, and the extrapolation ability of the machine learning algorithm is evaluated on a previously unseen data set, that is the test set. So So we want to discriminate between two different classes, signal and noise. The input images are the RGB multi-vector scalarons produced with coherent wave bursts, and the aim is to build a pipeline for a data-driven weekly model robust search. RGB time frequency plane means that we associate with each detector in the network a color. In our case, we have three detectors, LIGO Amford, LIGO Livingstone, and Virgo. So we assign red to Amford, green to Livingstone, and blue to Virgo. And what you see is that if two of the detectors, like in this example, red and green, so Amford and Livingstone has seen the can detect signal, what you have in the coincidence among the three detectors is that you see the feature you're looking at in the yellow color. If all three detectors will see the same signal, you will have it in white, and so on. If you have the red and the blue, so Amford and Virgo, that has seen the signal, you will end up with a signal that has the purple color. In the next slide, this one, I want to show you the difference in the time frequency between the case in which you have only noise and the case in which you have signal plus noise. So you see, in the first one, you have, again, the signature that is not present in the second plot. So what is the architecture of the algorithm? It's a reduced version of Inception ResNet that is based on TensorFlow backend. We train a number of parameters that was 98,997. This algorithm is 30 times more complex than the previous one that we use. And the task is treated as a multi-class classification problem. So we wanted to discriminate the event class and the noise class, and we used to do that the binary cross entropy. The training and the validation phase in real detector noise are done in 2 hours and 21 minutes using a GPU NVIDIA, while predicting the data set takes 3 milliseconds for each 2 second long images. Just to be a tad more precise, the scalogram that we give in input at the machine learning algorithm is divided in 256 pixels in time, 64 in frequency, times 3 because it's the number of detectors that are involved in the search. And the frequency range is between 0 and 2048 hertz, and the time range is between 0 and 2 seconds. So what are the data set? We consider a period in which the two LIGO advanced LIGO detectors and the Virgo one were online during the second observing run. So the noise is done through time shifted data to train the machine learning algorithm over the noise class. Regarding the training set is composed of phenomenological waveforms, in particular 7,000 images for each distance in the range between 0.2 and 3 kiloparsec, and random sky localization. The 75% of this set is used for training, and the 25% is using for validation. Then we have a so-called blind set that is again used composed of phenomenological waveforms, in particular 260,000 images with distances chosen in a uniform distribution between 0.2 and 15 kiloparsec. This set is not involved in any training or validation procedure. It's just a set that we need to benchmark the quality of the network. And then we have the test set that is composed of numerical simulation from the literatures, in particular 65,000 images in a distance between 0.1 and 50 kiloparsec. And this is the previously unseen set of data that the detector has to give the output on. The output of the network is a probability vector, theta, which contains the probabilities of the template belonging to one class or the other. And so the classification task is performed according to the threshold that is called the decision threshold. And so the template will be classified as event only if its probability overcomes the detection threshold. Otherwise, it will be classified as noise. Here you see the efficiency, false alarm rate, and false positive rate that are quantities that I will use in the plot starting from next one. So to be precise, we not only use binary cross entropy, but we use a weighted binary cross entropy with a weight equal to 2. So for us, it was 2 times more important to correctly classify the noise class rather than the event class. The plot that you see here, efficiency versus network SNR, is done in Gaussian noise because the previous work was only considering Gaussian noise. And in that case, what you see is that the efficiency is better, is higher than the previous work. Instead, the false alarm rate is lower than the level around 3.5 that was before. This is a snapshot coming from the validation step, in which again you want to increase the efficiency and try and maximize the efficiency and minimize the false alarm rate. Every time that you see the SNR is the network SNR. So the combination of the SNR of the 3 detectors in the network. Here you have the probability density versus theta in percentile. And I report these histograms because so first of all, the green one is the one that contains, the green histogram is the one that contains the real detector noise, and as it should, it peaks at 0. The other two contain signals, so they have to peak at 100. I'm showing this plot to display the robustness of the decision threshold at 65%, in which we can remove the majority of the real detector noise, losing only a tiny bit of signal. So this is one of the main results. This is the efficiency versus distance. And the two data sets that are shown are the blind set and the test set. So you see that for smaller distances, so around 1 to 2 kiloparsec, there is a discrepancy between the two of about 10%. If we lower the efficiency and we increase the distances, the lower limit is 60% in efficiency, reaching a distance of 15 kiloparsec. Unfortunately, it wasn't possible to compare our result with the reference that is the analysis in the advanced LIGO and Virgo data by the collaboration due to 2 different factors. So the first one is the fact that the false alarm rate of the 2 searches are different, and so it's not possible to make a fair comparison. And the second one is involves the types of simulation that we use for the search that are, even though they are a neutrino-driven explosion, but they are not the same of this paper. This is the other result, efficiency versus SNR. Again, this is network SNR. So for the network SNR that is bigger than 15 or 16, we have already 70% in efficiency, then, and it grows till 100%. What can we improve? So the improvement, of course, there are many improvements that we can do. Probably the most straightforward are the inclusion of the SASE structure in the search. We should also consider the 1% of the cases in which the progenitor is of the core collapse supernova is rapidly rotating. And so we are in the magnetorotating rotationally driven core collapse supernova. And also enlarge the network of the ground-based interferometer, including the Gagra detector, and so using the O3 data. These are my conclusions. So what we developed was a mini-inception ResNet neural network to look for 3D numerical simulation for supernova. In the case of the real detector noise for the second observing run of the advanced detector, we could detect the signal at a distance of 1 kiloparsec with high efficiency, and lowering the efficiency, we can reach values up to 15 kiloparsec, having 60% in efficiency. Of course, these are, I think, very promising results, and we need to work more to include all the possible extensions we can think of. And with this, thank you for your attention.